Turn with me in your Bibles to Ephesians chapter 2. Ephesians chapter 2, and we continue our study of the path into Christ from Ephesians chapter 2, verses 1 through 10. The path into Christ from Ephesians chapter 2, verses 1 through 10. The Bible is clear from the Old Testament through the New Testament that every believer will one day receive a resurrected and or glorified body. There is no exception to this. If a person has placed their trust in Jesus Christ, they will be resurrected. That is, if they've passed away before his return. And if they're alive, they will be translated into a glorified body. That is a guarantee. The question I want to ask with that understanding is, what will be the difference, or what will be some of the differences between the bodies we have now and the bodies we will one day have when we are resurrected slash translated? And I think a good passage, there are several that we could go to start looking at this, a good passage to look at, I want you in Ephesians chapter 2, and I don't have verses up on the screen. I will try to state the references a couple times in case you want to write this down just for this morning. But I think a good place to start is 1 Corinthians 15, verses 51 through 52. And if you turn there, we are going to be going back to Ephesians 2 just momentarily. So just be aware of that. 1 Corinthians 15, verses 51 through 52. This is what it says. Behold, I tell you a mystery. We will not all sleep, but we will all be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised imperishable, and we will be changed. The Apostle Paul is talking to a group of believers who, really, in the testimony of the New Testament, are among the most disobedient church there is. They are believers. There is no question about that. But they have fallen into many bad ways of thinking and a lot of bad practices. And thinking and practice often, though not always, often go together. And Paul is trying to correct this misunderstanding that they have. They should not be misunderstanding such a fundamental doctrine as the resurrection of the dead. And yet, that appears to be exactly what's going on among them. That for some reason, they have been taught or they have begun to think that there is no physical resurrection of the dead. Now, it doesn't seem that they were denying Christ's resurrection. It seems that they affirmed that, but Paul says that's totally inconsistent. If Christ has been raised, then certainly believers will be raised. If believers haven't been raised, then why would you expect or think that Christ has been raised? And this is what he says, and this is some verses back. He develops his thoughts further, but back in verse 16, this is what he says. For if the dead are not raised, not even Christ has been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, your faith is worthless. You are still in your sins. The logic is not to say your faith doesn't exist, Corinthians, but what would be the point of it? Because if the dead are not raised, then Christ is not raised. And if Christ has not risen, you cannot receive eternal life. You will not receive a resurrection body, the thing, very thing you're denying. And then you still live in a position before God of being spiritually dead. That is the most worthless thing you could possibly believe. That's the consistency. Now, I think about that and apply that to many modern-day ways that people think about Christianity. We could go back in history just a little bit, and I won't belabor the point, but around the turn of the 20th century, many people came over from Europe, primarily from German higher critical thinking, and brought with them all sorts of denials about the Bible. This is well documented, and it pretty much affected every single group within Christianity in America. And there are many people, generations down now, that still deny miracles in Scripture. And among those are Christ's resurrection. I think of one person in particular named John Dominic Crossan, who is a flat-out apostate. And he says, no, Christ was never physically raised. That's ridiculous. He was raised in our hearts. He lives today in our hearts, and we remember him through what the Bible says. You're still in your sins, if that's the case. That is a flat out denial of the powerful work that Jesus Christ did. This was a number of years ago. I was working in a grocery store, and a coworker of mine, we would talk often, and he was younger than I was, and I was always trying to encourage him to be in a local church and to get under good teaching. And I don't know where he stood spiritually. Some things it seemed like he understood about Christ. But one day, we got to talking about the rapture. And he goes, wait, you don't really believe that, do you? I'm like, you bet I believe that. Absolutely I believe that. Scripture says it, that we'll be, in 1 Thessalonians 4, that we will be caught up together with Christ. I absolutely believe it. He was astonished. There are people that do not believe in the resurrection, or they are very confused about it. And if that is the place where they land, this is all silliness. But that is not reality. This is the most authoritative word we have. And everything it says is true. And so when Paul says in 1 Corinthians 15, verses 51 through 52, I tell you a mystery, something that was previously unrevealed, but is now being revealed, we will all be changed. And notice his word, all. This isn't just a select group. It's going to happen at the same event. Every believer will be changed. He explains further, it's going to be that fast, in the twinkling of an eye, the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised imperishable. They cannot perish after that point, and we will be changed. What does it mean that we'll be changed? Now, we did look a little bit last week at Philippians chapter 3, verse 20 and 21, and it says that our bodies will be transformed to the glory of Jesus Christ. So we understand something about that. We talked about some related words that all kind of bring out similar ideas of a transformation or some type of change that takes place physically. Here we're dealing with a slightly different word in 1 Corinthians 15 when it says we will all be changed one time, and then he says it again, we will be changed. He uses the same word in Greek. And those words mean, or they come from a word that means another of a similar kind. That's what it comes from. Another of a similar kind. And if it is verbal, then that means to make something another of a similar kind. In other words, to transform it, to change it, is the idea. Sometimes this word is used actually in a monetary process, to exchange something. So you have one thing, you have money, depending on what culture and society, and this was the ancient world, they would have some type of currency that they would use, and that would be transferred or exchanged for something. It's actually used in Romans chapter 1, not in a monetary sense, but in speaking about the world and how hedonistic they are, that they have exchanged the glory of the incorruptible God for the low and earthly creatures that they worship. That's an exchange. So that's one usage. Sometimes it's used in the sense of redemption, to pay the purchase price of something, and by paying that price, you get the thing. But there's another interesting usage of this, and it actually is as a translation of the Hebrew. So in the Old Testament, sometimes when they brought it into Greek, they would use this word. There's a variety of contexts, but one sticks out to me as particularly illustrative of what we're talking about here. And that is, sometimes it talked about changing clothes. Changing clothes. In one instance, we have something that David does in which he changes his clothes, and it's in 2 Samuel chapter 12. What's gone on here is that David has committed a sin, the most grievous sin he committed in his life. At least that's documented in Scripture, and we can surmise that's true, that this is the worst of what he committed. And that was that he stole another man's wife, Bathsheba, and put together a plot to have Uriah killed so that he could take her for himself, and also because he had already impregnated her and had to try to cover everything up. And so through these circumstances, it wasn't until he was confronted by Nathan, and Nathan tells this story about a rich man stealing a poor man's lamb, one that the poor man valued so deeply. And David is furious over this story. He says, "You are the man. You're the one that did this to Uriah." And so the promise by God was that the son that is going to be born to Bathsheba from this, I don't like the word affair, but that's the word that comes to mind right now, this affair, this very despicable act that you've engaged in, that son will die. And so when the son was born, he was immediately sick. And David fasted, and he prayed, and he begged that God would not take the life of his son. But God had already prophesied through Nathan this son would die. And sure enough, the time came, and his son died. At that point, what did David do? 2 Samuel chapter 12, verse 20. "So David arose from the ground, washed, anointed himself, and changed his clothes, and he came into the house of the Lord and worshipped. Then he came to his own house, and when he requested, they set food before him, and he ate," which was very odd to his servants because his son has just died, and now he is acting the opposite of what they would think. They would think that he'd maybe be holding out hope up until it, and then when his son died, he would put on sackcloth and ashes and start mourning and fasting. But David picks himself up, pulls himself back together. He knows there's nothing he can do to change it. He even, in fact, says, and I believe that this is exactly as it sounds because he uses this to comfort himself, that his son cannot come back to him, but he will go to him. I believe that is talking about the fact that when a child dies, when they are below a certain age, it doesn't specify, that they go to be with the Lord. God is that merciful. And so that's what takes place here. But notice what David did. 2 Samuel 12, 20. David arose, he washed himself, he anointed himself, and he changed his clothes. There we go. Changed. It is often used to speak of putting on a change of clothes. And I think that speaks to what's going on, at least in a picture way. It's vivid. It helps us understand. What are we talking about? 2 Corinthians 5 uses similar language. Paul there uses a couple of illustrations. He talks about the body as being a house. He talks about the body as being a tent. He even talks about it as being clothing. That if you don't have a body, which he says, to be absent from the body, that's when people die, is to be present with the Lord. That's believers only, though. And in that sense, they are naked. That is not the final place that they should be, is disembodied in the intermediate state. And no believer will remain that way. There's coming a day when all believers will be finally clothed with their resurrection body. And so we have to understand that when we're talking about a change, 1 Corinthians 15, 51, and 52, we will all be changed. We are talking about a substantive difference between what we experience now, the bodies we have now, and the bodies we will have. It's going to be different. It's not going to be entirely different. It's going to be similar, but it will be different. So what will it be like? Listen to 1 John chapter 3, verse 2. John is encouraging believers that they should live for the Lord because they're his children and they're related to Jesus Christ now because they've believed in him. And the only consistent thing would be if you are in him and you are of him, that you should look like him right here, right now. Notice his consistent logic. He says, 1 John 3, 2, "Beloved, now we are children of God, and it has not appeared as yet what we will be. We know that when he appears, we will be like him, because we will see him just as he is." Did you catch that? We will be like him. What will this change be? What will our bodies be like? Well, the starting point is they will be something like Jesus Christ. Now, we can't presume that it will be an always like Christ. We're talking about God himself taking human flesh. I would assume that there's going to be some differences, but there is going to be a major similarity when we are translated into glorified bodies that we will be like Jesus Christ. And what was Christ like when he was raised from the dead? Luke chapter 24, verse 39. In Luke 24, verse 39, this is after Jesus has risen from the dead, and he is appearing before his disciples, and he says to them, because they are afraid of him, he says, "See my hands and my feet, that it is I myself. Touch me and see, for a spirit does not have flesh and bones, as you see that I have." And this is right after he just appeared among them. Right through a wall. He's just with them. They have a locked door. They're in a room. And he appears. And then he says to them, "I'm flesh and bone. I'm in a physical, a real body. This isn't some spirit floating around. Jesus was as real as you and I when he was raised from the dead in a real body. It's different, but it's a real body." Some people get confused, even within 1 Corinthians 15, because of some of the language that Paul uses. You can think of 1 Corinthians 15, verse 50, which is just the preceding verse of what we read earlier. And Paul says that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God. So what do people conclude? Oh, well, the kingdom of God isn't a physical kingdom. It's not a real kingdom. Hold on. Pump the brakes. What's the context? It's talking about the resurrection, real physical bodies. That's the whole point of what he's talking about. This isn't some pretend resurrection. This isn't some spiritual event that, you know, people just imagine it in their minds. We're talking about real bodies being raised. And in that context, he says, flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God. What does that mean? Your natural body that you live in now, the perishable and corrupt form of your body, cannot inherit it. God will do something to us to translate us into imperishable bodies, no longer natural bodies, no longer corrupt bodies. 1 Corinthians 15, verse 44 says, "It," speaking of our bodies, "it is sown a natural body, it is raised a spiritual body. If there is a natural body, there is also a spiritual body." And again, people read that and they think, oh, spiritual. So that must mean that it's not like physical. No, it's material. It's spiritual in the sense that spirit and body have finally been brought back together perfectly the way God intended from the beginning. The thing that Adam and Eve lost in the garden. So yes, it is a truly spiritual body because it doesn't decay, it doesn't wear out. It's not like our bodies right now that are in the process of dying. This is a spiritual body that will last forever. And it is the same body that we have now. Again, it will be different. There's a change to it, but it is the same body. And I gather this because we're going to be made like Christ. His body was the same body he had before he was put on a cross. Because when he appears to his disciples in another context in John chapter 20, and he shows them his body, it has the characteristics of before he was raised from the dead. And how do we know that? It says John 20, verse 20. And when he had said this, he showed them both his hands and his side. The disciples then rejoiced when they saw the Lord. And then Thomas hears about this. He says, unless I see those things, I will not believe. Jesus appears before him and says, look, touch, feel my hands, feel my side. Thomas doesn't even have to do that at that point. He instantly believes. He says, my Lord and my God. It is the same body that Jesus Christ had. So we're not talking about God throwing away our old bodies and manufacturing a new body. We are going to be the same people, the same bodies. If somebody was lost at sea or any other circumstance that we could possibly think of, God is not going to have any difficulty in materializing the same body again. I can't wrap my mind around it, but I can take Scripture at its word. God will give us the same bodies, but changed to an imperishable nature. And then with that, there are some big changes that will take place that are revealed in other places, but really in a condensed form at the very end of Scripture in Revelation 21. Talking about, remember we talked about this, the home that every single believer will live in, the New Jerusalem. Well, the only people that are going to be fit to live in the New Jerusalem must have bodies that conform to the criteria. It says this about those who will live in the New Jerusalem in Revelation 21, verse 4. And he will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and there will no longer be any death. There will no longer be any mourning or crying or pain. The first things have passed away. The key to all of that, the thing that makes all of that work, is when it says there will no longer be any death. Well, when there's no death, there's no mourning. There's no crying. There's no pain. All of those things are removed. Nobody will perish again in that state in the New Jerusalem. And with that means, if death has been removed, finally and fully, that is a guarantee that sin has also been removed finally and fully. And that's what it says just a short ways down in Revelation 21, verse 27. It says, and nothing unclean and no one who practices abomination and lying shall ever come into it, but only those whose names are written in the Lamb's book of life. What that doesn't mean is that people who are Christians and lie today, oh, they'll never be in there. No, we're talking about at the end, in perfected, glorified bodies, there's never going to be a person in the New Jerusalem who ever lies or practices abomination, and nothing unclean will be in there because sin will be done away with forever. This is what we have to look forward to. This is no little thing. Let me just ask you. I'm younger than most people here, and I can tell you, I've woken up and not felt great. I've hurt myself. I've experienced death. I've had a lot of things that are impacted by these statements happen in my short life. I can only imagine that probably every other person here has been impacted by these things. It is a promise and it is a guarantee. When we receive those bodies, when we are home with the Lord, you will never again experience those things. You'll never wake up sore. You'll never get in a terrible car accident. You'll never lose a loved one. That's over. That prayer list we have back there that is filled with concerns about people's health, troubles, pain, things that cause the shedding of tears and mourning, they're gone. You will never face that again, totally freed. I would say that the promise of the resurrection is one of the greatest promises Scripture has ever made, and it's among many others. We have something to look forward to. And as we've developed this entire topic really from one word in Ephesians 2:8 to this point, we have looked at how this is a part of our heavenly citizenship. By being a citizen of heaven, which only comes about by placing your trust in Jesus Christ alone, we have a home in the New Jerusalem already prepared for us. In fact, we're already spiritually in heaven right now. We have the opportunity for rewards, and it is a guarantee every single believer at the same event, well, at least every believer in the church age, at the same event, will receive a glorified body. That's something to look forward to. That's the fulfillment of our heavenly citizenship. And we'll pick up on that topic after we read from Ephesians chapter 2, beginning in verse 1. "And you were dead in your trespasses and sins, in which you formerly walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, of the spirit that is now working in the sons of disobedience. Among them we too all formerly lived in the lusts of our flesh, indulging the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and were by nature children of wrath, even as the rest. But God, being rich in mercy because of his great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in our transgressions, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved, and raised us up with him, and seated us with him in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, so that in the ages to come he might show the surpassing riches of his grace and kindness toward us in Christ Jesus. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God, not as a result of works, so that no one may boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand so that we would walk in them." Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the path that you have created for any person who can possibly hear the message about Jesus Christ and what he has done and believe in him alone. And Lord, we thank you that this is such a radical difference from what the facts were about us before we're saved. We know that we were children of wrath. We know that we were sons of disobedience. We know that we were positionally dead, that we were in a position of sin and totally separated from you. And yet, through the simple work of Jesus Christ, not simple in the sense of what he had to do, but simple in the sense of how simple you make it for us to receive it, through that work, we can be placed into Christ Jesus, and then we get to receive all of the benefits of everything he did, literally riding on his coattails, getting the benefits of dying to sin, being buried, being raised with him, being seated with him in the heavenlies. All of that, all of those are works that Christ has accomplished, Lord, and you have allowed all of those to be attributed to us. We get the benefits. Lord, I thank you for that fact. I thank you that you have truly made salvation a very simple thing, that any person who believes in Jesus Christ alone receives eternal life and all of these other spiritual blessings with it. And Lord, I pray that we would be bold in proclaiming that message, that we would tell this world around us, people who are, that we're no better than, that they can have eternal life just like we have received through Christ. Lord, I pray that we would be eager to share this message with the world, with those that we love and care about who need to know Jesus Christ. Lord, I pray for opportunities there for all of us. Thank you for giving your Son to die for us and for the fact that he has secured eternal life. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. As we jump back in, we look at Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8. And again, we've been looking at this word, one word, saved. For by grace you have been saved. And why is it so important that we look at this single word? Because this is one of the most misused words in all of Scripture. For far too long, people have given evangelistic messages where they just find any old passage in Scripture that uses the word salvation and they give a gospel presentation using it. And most of the time, or much of the time, The context isn't about spiritual salvation at all. So the conditions that are in that passage, they are trying to bring with them and put commitment and all sorts of effort on the part of people hearing it as a way for them to receive eternal life. And that's just wrong. So we have to be careful. When it says, for by grace you have been saved, the first thing we should say to ourselves is, what does it mean saved? The word basically means rescued. And so we've been careful and we looked at the difference between passages that are talking about temporal or physical deliverance and passages that are talking about spiritual deliverance. And once we've rightly understood the difference between the two, we look at this and we say, yes, this is in fact a passage about spiritual rescue or deliverance. Okay, with that information then, we've understood that there are different contexts in the New Testament about how salvation works. Some talk about past tense, some talk about present tense, and some talk about future tense. And to confuse those is to do great harm to our understanding of how salvation works. Past tense salvation is a point in time event. The moment a person believes, they are permanently justified and they receive eternal life. That is past tense salvation. But that then begins the process, the lifelong process from that point of present tense salvation. If that one, the past tense, is being saved from the penalty of sin, the present tense is being saved from the power of sin. Yes, we're saved permanently, once and for all, but we still live in corrupted bodies in a sinful world. And how are we supposed to, as God's children, live in this life? Well, God gives us the power through His Holy Spirit, through the new nature we have, and through His Scriptures to begin living for Him as we yield to what we know to be true about us that we find in His Word and the things that He calls us to. So that's the process. And when we rightly distinguish that, then we can look at the future tense of salvation. That there is coming one day for every believer a salvation in the sense of being saved from the presence of sin altogether and forever. And that, similar to past tense salvation, is a point in time event. It's not a process. It happens at a point in time. Well, from the passages we've looked at, what we've realized is that point in time happens at Christ's return. In some sense, it's true that when a believer dies and they go to be home with the Lord, they're never going to experience sin again. That is true, but they don't yet have their glorified bodies. So that's the big difference. When Christ returns, the fulfillment of nearly everything at that point, that we still await the New Jerusalem at that point, but nearly everything, as at least in the sense of our bodies, is going to be perfected and we will never struggle with sin or its effects ever again. That is future tense salvation. And that comes about as a fulfillment of the heavenly citizenship we are given the moment we are saved. Here's why I've brought all of these things up. What do we do with all of this right now? I think we already see many of the implications and how it affects our lives. But remember how we got to the heavenly citizenship. There is a parallel passage. They are talking with different language. They're both by Paul. But they are basically talking about the same type of thinking in the believer's life. Focusing on above, heaven, and future, our future tense salvation. When Christ returns. And that's what we have in Colossians chapter 3, verses 1 through 2. Remember, several weeks ago we had looked at this. We're coming back to it. Colossians 3, verses 1 through 2. Here's what it says. Therefore, if you have been raised up with Christ, keep seeking the things above. Where's our citizenship? Heaven. Where's heaven? At least in Scripture, consistently, above. Keep seeking the things above, where our heavenly citizenship is. What Colossians 3, Paul says here, is where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. Verse 2, set your mind on the things above, not on the things that are on earth. So we are to seek the things above, and we are to set our minds on the things above. And yes, those are parallel expressions. They have slightly different emphases, but they are basically saying the same thing or filling out one another. So there's three things that I would gather from this. Remember this. Colossians 3, verses 1 through 2, seek things above, set your mind on things above. The first thing I would gather from this is from the words, set your mind. And this tells me that we are to shape our worldview, the entire way we see the world around us and our thinking, on heavenly things and heavenly perspective. Not experience, because our experience is drastically different from the position we have in heaven. And are presently, as a fact, we are seated in heaven. But our experience is very different from that. So the way that we set our minds, our thinking, our worldview on heavenly things is we have to go to the book that tells us about these heavenly things. There's a verse that I think helps us understand this a little more, and that's in Acts chapter 28. In Acts chapter 28, verse 22. Now, this is at the very end of the book of Acts. Paul has just been on a journey from Israel all the way to Rome. He's appealed to Caesar. He wants to see Caesar. He's been wanting to get to Rome for a while, and so this was his opportunity. Problem is, he has to go in chains. He doesn't get to go as a free man. So he is taken, even amid shipwreck and all sorts of other circumstances, he finally gets to Rome, and he's put on house arrest there. And the convenient thing about that is, although he's not free to come and go, he is able to have people come to him. And what was Paul's way of working in ministry before? He did this everywhere he went. He would go to the Jew first, and then to the Greek, or the Gentile. Romans 1:16, to the Jew first, and then to the Gentile. And so he often would go to the synagogue, every place he went. He'd go to the synagogue first, he would preach Jesus Christ to them, and if they rejected them, or what he was saying, then he would go to the Gentile. And so what we find is, even at the end of the book of Acts, when he's on house arrest, and he has little opportunity, the first thing, or among the first things that he does, is he calls the Jews in Rome to come to him because he wants to share this truth. And it seems that they've heard a little bit about this sect, they call it, of Christians, but they're not fully aware of all that's going on. And so they want to know from Paul personally what this is all about. And so in Acts 28, verse 22, Paul says this, or they say this to him, excuse me. They say, but we desire to hear from you what your views are. For concerning this sect, it is known to us that it is spoken against everywhere. Our word, set your mind, is used when they say, we desire to hear from you what your views are. What are your views? What's your mindset? What are you setting your mind on? The word can literally be translated, what is your thinking? What are you thinking about? In Colossians 3, it could be translated that way. Think about things above. It's brought out with this sense of what views you hold. What are your beliefs? What are the things that you think? And where is your mind? What is its preoccupation is basically the idea. That helps me understand. What is a mindset? What is a to set my mind on things above is to be preoccupied with heavenly thinking, not thinking like, well, I'm not even going to pay attention to anything around me. This earth doesn't matter. I forget about everything. That's not heavenly thinking. Heavenly thinking is based on the position that we have, all that that tells us about our future and what we have to look forward to, and how that impacts us right now to interact with the world today. That's setting our minds. Interacting with the world from a truly biblical and heavenly perspective. The second thing we're to do with this understanding, and I get this primarily from Philippians 3:20, but again, we're talking about parallel ideas. One says, Colossians 3 says, set your mind or seek things above. Philippians 3 says that you have a citizenship in heaven, and it says, from which we eagerly await a Savior. Our citizenship in heaven is the place from which we eagerly await. Eagerly. Not just waiting around. Eagerly waiting for. This wording is used in Romans 8:19. And in Romans chapter 8, in this section, Paul is talking about how there is a groaning and a longing in the world, generally in the creation, and also among people, that everybody has the sense in them that something is not right in the world we live in today. The fact that our bodies are wearing out, yes, we all recognize this. Yes, we all accept it to some degree. But I think even the unbeliever, the person who would say, I don't even think God exists, knows something's not right about that. And especially those who don't believe in God, they have the most to fear because once it's over, from their vantage point, there's nothing. Except they're going to find out, sadly, there is an eternal separation in hell from God. So in Romans chapter 8, the entire creation, it's being personified, but it seems to operate and function in a way that it's groaning, it's not right, it's anxious over this situation. And he says, for the anxious longing of the creation waits eagerly. Anxious longing, just begging for, waiting for, and it waits eagerly for what? The revealing of the sons of God. That time when we will receive our glorified bodies. And why does it do this? Because it was subjected to futility. That's in verse 20. It was subjected to futility. What are the things that are futile about our world? Well, how about death? How about things that are created dying and things decaying and wearing out and everything? I mean, living in South Mississippi, I don't think we have to look too far to see the effects of rust and wear on buildings and cars and all sorts of things. This is all the futility of this world. Things wearing out. It's not right. It's the world we live in, but it's not right. And there is coming a time when that will be over. Well, take that idea, the world or even us longing for the bodies that God has promised us, the world waiting for us to receive those bodies so that this futility can be put behind it all. And understand that that's the eager waiting that citizens of heaven should have for their Savior. Because not only is He our Savior, and we want to see Him and we want to be with Him, but He brings all of these other things with Him as well, the fulfillment of that citizenship. And then the third thing that I think helps us understand how to apply this heavenly thinking, this heavenly citizenship to our lives right here, right now, is in Colossians 3, verse 1, when it says, keep seeking the things above. Seeking. What does it mean to seek the things above? I think we get a glimpse of this in Matthew chapter 6, verse 33. Now, I'm going to set this in the context, and I'm careful with this because I think people go into the Gospels and they just pull everything out and apply it very loosely. And I have to understand the context here is about a nation, Israel, who has a special relationship with God by covenant that no other nation has. And a part of that is that they are promised a king, that's Jesus Christ, He comes. And when He comes, He brings a kingdom. And although the kingdom was offered, it was available, He's holding it out to them basically, they rejected Him. in Matthew chapter 12 by saying that he was performing his miracles by the power of Satan. And so that generation of Israel was put off, and they did not receive their kingdom at that time. But before that event happened, as Jesus was, in fact, offering the kingdom to the Jewish nation, and he was encouraging them to change their way of thinking because they had fallen into a lot of self-righteousness, living by law, thinking that they could merit themselves before God, and also adding to God's word. A lot of bad things were going on there. In that context, in Jesus correcting their thinking and offering the kingdom, he corrects their thinking that often what goes on is people are seeking the things of this earth. And how do they seek it? By storing up treasures here, building wealth and accumulating. He's not saying don't have money and don't have property or possessions. He's simply saying if that's what you're seeking after, if that's the focus, if that's where your treasure is, it's all going to wear out. It's all going to go away. That is a very empty thing to pursue. Instead, he says in Matthew 6:33, but seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you. Seeking his kingdom, having the priority that the most important thing to you, the thing that you desire the most and you would pursue the most, is the kingdom that only the King Jesus Christ could bring. And that is all that your heart is poured into. That is your primary concern. That's where your treasure should be. That's what he's saying to the Jewish nation. Now, we know the kingdom is coming. That's for certain. But how do we apply that type of seeking, that type of attitude to today? Well, we already have a heavenly position, a heavenly citizenship, but we don't experience it yet. We should have an attitude that is, we're propelled by our desire to finally experience it. And the things we do in life should be informed by that desire. That the most important thing in every single believer's life, above anything, should be the heavenly citizenship that we have, that Jesus Christ secured, and that we will experience with him one day. Nothing should ever be put above that. How do we set our mind on things above? How does our heavenly citizenship impact us now? How do we seek the things above? By keeping our minds focused on them and letting them impact us. See, I've said this before, and I think this is one of the biggest battles within Christianity, is there is a fundamental misunderstanding about what the Christian life is. It is a battle of the mind. It is not rituals. It is not all of these other accoutrements and things that people bring into churches and Christianity. It is the mind. The Christian life is first and foremost here. It starts here. It starts with us knowing who we are in Christ, reckoning that position to ourselves. This is straight from Romans 6. Reckoning it. That is accounting it to be true. And then yielding as instruments in the hand of God before him. It is a walk by faith and not by sight. That is the Christian life. And that is another way, among the many others that Paul uses, of saying, seek the things above. Set your mind on things above. All of this can affect us right now and change our lives. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the fact that you have secured our future tense salvation. And with that all of these promises are already ours. We don't experience them in full. There is a delay to really these wonderful things, but they already belong to us. And not because of anything we have done or deserve, but because of your Son. Lord, we cannot say it enough. Jesus Christ should be exalted above all. We do look forward to the day that Philippians 2 says, every knee shall bow and every tongue confess, even those who have rejected him, even those who have hated Jesus Christ, no one will be exempt. Every knee will bow and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of you, God the Father. We thank you for that fact. We look forward to it. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.